In the whirlwind of royal interactions and cultural nuances, Prince George recently made headlines with a simple yet heartwarming gesture of a hug that's stirring up conversations. It seems to be poking holes in Meghan Markle's previous comments about the British aversion to hugs. You know, Meghan once mentioned that her fondness for hugging took some Brits by surprise, even going as far as to say it was jarring for them. It's a tale as old as time, or at least as old as Meghan's entry into the royal scene, where her American ease with embraces clashed with the more reserved British demeanor. Remember that time Prince Harry brought up how Meghan's attempt to hug William and Kate didn't exactly go as planned? He painted it as a bit of a misstep, showcasing the cultural divide between Meghan's open-armed approach and William's more restrained reception. Initially, it was laughed off as a quirky cultural mismatch, but looking back, it seems to underline deeper issues of fitting in and meeting expectations. Meghan has always stood by her huggy nature, attributing it to her American roots and suggesting it might be a bit misunderstood on this side of the pond. Yet, her recounting of that first awkward encounter with William and Kate in a Netflix documentary series felt a bit off to some. Critics argue she seemed to overplay her affectionate side, possibly as a way to unsettle Kate or to forge a closer bond with William, a strategy that raised eyebrows from the get-go. However, the narrative took an interesting turn with the emergence of a heartwarming photo of Mike Tyndall embracing Prince George, shared by Stephanie Sidley on X. You know the platform formerly known as Twitter. The image not only captured a genuine moment of warmth, but also reignited discussions about Meghan's comments on hugging. This time, the conversation seems to be shifting, with more voices openly questioning the sincerity of Meghan and Harry's portrayal of events, a stark contrast to previous times when critics were quickly labeled as biased or worse. This evolving dialogue highlights a broader reassessment of public figures and their narratives, suggesting that perhaps the issue was never with the British discomfort towards hugs, but rather with the dynamics surrounding Meghan herself. It's a reminder that actions, intentions, and cultural expressions are always open to interpretation, especially in the complex tapestry of royal interactions and public perception. The conversation around Meghan Markle's entrance into the royal circle just took another fascinating turn, with more folks starting to view her and Prince Harry's actions through a skeptical lens. It seems the tide is shifting, with accusations of opportunism and hypocrisy becoming louder and clearer. It's about time they were called out, some are saying, pointing to what they see as a pattern of behavior that doesn't exactly scream integrity. In an interesting twist, Jack Royston, a journalist who once rode the wave of support for Meghan and Harry, has started to show signs of a change in tune. Writing for Newsweek, Royston's recent critiques juxtapose his previous praises, painting a picture of someone wrestling with their perception of the couple. This back-and-forth stance could hint at a broader shift, especially now that Meghan and Harry's PR guru, Ashley Henson, has exited stage left, potentially thinning out the flurry of flattering coverage they've been accustomed to. Diving into the specifics, Royston revisited Meghan's comments from their Netflix documentary, where she reminisced about her first meeting with William and Kate. Picture this: Meghan, in ripped jeans and barefoot, ready to welcome royalty. She shared, "I've always been a hugger. Didn't realize that was really jarring for a lot of Brits." But maybe it wasn't just the hug that caught them off guard. The casual dress code, especially the choice of ripped jeans and the barefoot greeting, might not have meshed well with royal expectations. And then there's the commentary on her feet, which, let's be honest, feels a bit much and unnecessarily personal. However, Meghan's observation about the formality of royal life, both in public and private, strikes a chord. Her portrayal of the royal family as perhaps overly stiff and formal might not sit well with everyone, hinting at a deeper cultural divide than just a misunderstood hug. Meghan's narrative of feeling like an outsider trying to navigate the complex etiquette of royal life raises questions about tradition, openness, and the clash of cultures. It's a reminder that behind the palace gates, the blending of backgrounds and expectations can create quite the stir, offering a glimpse into the challenges of finding one's place in a world bound by centuries of protocol. Meghan Markle's commentary on the royal family has sparked quite the debate, especially her hints that the Windsors might not be as warm and cuddly behind closed doors as one might hope. She's been known to throw what some perceive as shade, wrapped in a veneer of innocence. "I didn't mean it like that," she might say, yet there's a growing consensus that perhaps she did mean just that. If Meghan finds herself at a loss for positive anecdotes about the royals, critics argue she might lean towards embellishment, casting the family in a less affectionate light than some believe to be true. Enter Richard Jackson, the man behind the documentary on King Charles III's coronation year, who offers a contrasting view. His time with the royal family, documented for the BBC, painted a picture of a clan that's not only affectionate, but tightly knit across generations. What struck me particularly is how extraordinarily affectionate they are, Jackson observed, hinting at a warmth that feels both familial and inclusive, a sentiment echoed in the celebrations of national milestones. So who do we believe? Richard Jackson. With his firsthand experience and hours of footage showing the royals in their natural habitat, or Meghan Markle, whose royal narrative has been met with both sympathy and skepticism, Jackson's account suggests a closeness that contradicts Meghan's portrayal, offering up a glimpse into the private world of a family that's often only seen from a distance. The saga doesn't stop with just the family dynamics. It extends into the public displays of affection, or PDA, that have become a hot topic. Meghan and Harry, in their time together as working royals, were hardly shy about showing their love for each other in public. This stood in stark contrast to William and Kate, who, while not completely averse to a subtle touch or shared look, generally keep their affection more under wraps. Critics argue that William and Kate's reserved demeanor isn't for lack of love, but a reflection of their understanding of the roles they are to play as future king and queen. The expectation is not for constant physical reassurance, but a partnership grounded in mutual respect and the occasional understated gesture of support. This narrative invites us to question how affection is displayed and perceived, especially in the goldfish bowl of public life, where every gesture is scrutinized. It challenges the notion that affection must always be visible to be real, suggesting instead that the bonds between the royals might be expressed in ways that go beyond the reach of the public eye. The debate around Meghan Markle's claims regarding British etiquette and affection continues to unfold, with new insights challenging her perspective. It's interesting to note how physical gestures within the royal family are scrutinized, with Meghan's habit of touching Harry often interpreted as more than just an act of love. Critics argue that this could be seen as her trying to assert influence or guide him, a stark contrast to the traditional forms of respect and affection observed in the royal family. The documentary about King Charles III's coronation year, featuring Richard Jackson's commentary, offered a timely counter-narrative. It showcased moments of warmth and affection, such as the king's heartfelt greetings to William and Catherine, complete with handshakes and cheek kisses. This imagery directly contradicts Meghan's assertion that Brits find hugging uncomfortable, revealing a more nuanced understanding of personal space and affection. From an American standpoint, it's worth mentioning that not everyone appreciates a hug upon first meeting. Challenging Meghan's claim about hugging being universally embraced by Americans, her approach, intended to convey warmth and genuineness, might not always land as expected, highlighting cultural differences in expressions of warmth. Furthermore, the documentary highlighted the significance of curtsying within the royal context, showcasing Catherine's curtsy to the king as a deep sign of respect and affection. This act, steeped in tradition, symbolizes recognition of the royal hierarchy, something Meghan seemed reluctant to engage with fully. Her resistance to this form of protocol underscores a broader struggle with the royal family's established norms and her place within them. Meghan's discomfort with curtsying, as revealed in her documentary series, points to a fundamental clash of expectations and cultural norms. While curtsying is a symbol of respect and affection within the royal family, Meghan's reluctance to embrace this tradition may reflect her challenges in adapting to the royal way of life. Her journey within the monarchy is marked by these moments of cultural and protocol misunderstandings, offering a glimpse into the complex dynamics of blending into the royal family while maintaining one's identity. Meghan Markle's journey with the royal family has been a roller coaster of moments, some of which have sparked controversy. One such instance was her curtsy to the late Queen Elizabeth II, a gesture that, while intended to show respect, ended up ruffling feathers among observers. This incident isn't isolated. It seems to be part of a broader narrative where Meghan's actions stir the pot, only for her to later plead unawareness. However, ignorance hardly serves as a shield, especially when Meghan, by her own admission, chose to sidestep the advice and guidance extended to her. This deliberate choice to not engage deeply with the customs and expectations laid before her strips away any veil of innocence from the misunderstandings that followed. Upon her entry into the royal fold, Meghan's approach was markedly different from the path traditionally trodden by royal newcomers. Seeking instant love and approval, she deviated from the slow and steady route of earning respect and understanding through perseverance and patience. This desire for quick validation, juxtaposed with what some view as a lack of effort to genuinely connect with the royal family's ways, has led to a series of missteps and misunderstandings. Now, with Meghan's current standing in the US and an apparent estrangement from the UK, the long-term impact of these choices is coming into sharper focus. Maybe she was overwhelmed, or perhaps underestimated. The complexity of her new life, but the outcome remains the same. Switching gears to the Christmas Day snub video discussion, which explored King Charles's Christmas speech that conspicuously left out any mention of Meghan and Harry. The video pondered whether this omission was a subtle message and applauded the king for focusing his address on those in service. Viewers chimed in with their thoughts, with one notable comment from Natural Habitat Siriwam 1, highlighting that the speech's essence was not about royal family dynamics, but rather a message of unity and tradition aimed at the public, the UK, and Commonwealth nations. This perspective appreciates the continuation of a long-standing tradition, by King Charles echoing the sentiments of many who see the royal Christmas message as a beacon of continuity and communal spirit. Your thoughts and insights under the video have sparked a rich dialogue, emphasizing the diverse ways in which royal actions and decisions are interpreted by the public. It's clear that the dynamics within the royal family and their interactions with the public continue to fascinate and provoke discussion, highlighting the enduring interest in the intersection of tradition, personal narratives, and public duties. Diving into the heart of the royal discourse, King Charles' Christmas speech subtly reminded us of the royal focus on service and community, subtly sidelining Harry and Meghan's absence from these efforts. It's an omission that might sting for the couple, hinting at a perceived oversight that could be felt as a personal slight. This scenario plays into the narrative that Harry and Meghan perhaps feel the royal spotlight mirrors their own fixation with the institution they left behind. The conversation around this topic is rich with varied opinions, as seen in the comments under the Christmas Day snub discussion. Wendy Marston, for example, paints a picture of Harry's transformation from a beloved prince to someone led astray by negative influences. This viewpoint sparks a debate, with Christine Hall suggesting an alternative angle that Harry's flaws were always present, but shielded by the royal veneer. This back and forth presents a complex portrait of Harry, one that might only be fully understood in the wake of a hypothetical split from Meghan. Such a scenario, as grim as it may sound, is speculated to reveal the true dynamics of Harry's personality and whether his recent path was a divergence from his true self or a revelation of his core. Shirley Wood's comment brings another dimension to the discussion, emphasizing the king's prioritization of the people over personal dramas. From Shirley's perspective, the king has already extended to Harry and Meghan the independence they sought, framing their current predicament as the result of their own choices. This viewpoint underscores a broader sentiment that the Sussexes' narrative is largely self-authored, including their financial and media-related maneuvers. This rich tapestry of opinions offers a window into the public's evolving relationship with royal narratives, reflecting a spectrum of sympathies, critics, and speculations. The dialogue around Harry and Meghan, contrasted with the royal family's public engagements, highlights a fascinating intersection of personal choices, public perceptions, and the enduring allure of royal storytelling. Shirley's take brings an interesting angle to the ongoing dialogue about the Sussexes, suggesting that King Charles has bigger fish to fry than to dwell on Meghan and Harry's latest moves or musings. According to her, the royal family is far more focused on their duties and the positive impact they can make, rather than getting tangled in the narrative spun by the couple from their base in Montecito. This perspective posits that any critical volleys from the Sussex camp are less a threat to the monarchy and more a potential pitfall for Meghan and Harry themselves. Shirley hints at a sort of natural consequence. Where continuous barbs thrown by the Sussexes might only lead to their own reputational harm, allowing the royals to maintain their course towards positive contributions, undistracted by the noise. It's a viewpoint that reflects a broader sentiment of wishing for less drama and more focus on the constructive roles that members of the royal family play. The conversation around Meghan and Harry's place in the public eye and their relationship with the rest of the royal family continues to evolve, with opinions like Shirley's adding layers to the complex narrative surrounding the Sussexes and their dynamic with the institution they've stepped back from.